Thank you for the invitation and for the introduction. So the work I'm going to talk about is, let me go to the first slide, is a part of an approach to algebraic differential equations from model theory that started with the study of universal differential fields called differentially closed field. And so I give you, there are three papers which are important in the model theory of differentially closed field. And so the first one is when they were axiomatized for the first time by Bloom in 68. And so what is the approach is that if you work in this series, the basic quantifier free formulas are systems of algebraic differential equations. And you can do what you usually do in model theory. You associate to them a definable set, which is the set of their solutions in one of these universal differential fields. And you start studying this definable set. So this approach is based, so according to the theory you start with, the structure of definable set is very different. And here, this is based on an approach that is known as Hilbert trichotomy, that in well-behaved first-order theory, you can classify the definable set using this kind of arguments that there are essentially three kinds of indecomposable definable sets. And this philosophy and the idea that these kind of things could be true has been a driving force in the development in model theory, especially in the 90s, and providing effective conditions for this principle to hold. And one of these examples is the case of differential algebra, so a field with a derivation. But you've got other examples, and this kind of framework is not really sensible to the geometric framework you start with. If you start with differential algebra, difference algebra, or Erdős geometry, the structure of finite set in algebraic geometry, this kind of indecomposable, these three kinds of indecomposable definable set do not change. So the first thing I'm going to do is to start by describing what it looks like for differential equations. So what these three classes of differential equation looks like. So the first one is the locally modular case called like that. And this is the one that made the model theory of differential field famous, because of the proof of Ruchowski of Mordellon conjecture for function fields of characteristic zero. And so the first class of equation is related to differential equation that appears in this proof. And let me describe the simplest equation of this form. You start with a non-isotrivial family of elliptic curve. You look at the universal vector extension. And then there's a unique vector field compatible with the group structure and which extends the vector field d over dt on A1. And so, from the model theoretic perspective, they will be characterized by structural property. So let me give you one of these structural properties. So the equation that I define is of dimension 3. It doesn't have a rational integral, but it admits countably many invariant algebraic curves. And all this kind of equation, we have similar properties. Okay, this doesn't characterize them entirely, but this, they are characterized by structural properties of this form. The second example I want, the second class of differential equation are the algebraic differential equation that admit a differential Galois theory in the change of Kolchin. So I'm writing plus or minus epsilon because it's not exactly true that they are exactly these ones. And so as examples, you see that you've got linear differential equation, Rickettsian equations, elliptic differential equations. And one difference with the theory of Kolchin is that Kolchin always requires the differential equation not to have rational integrals. But here, we can allow them to have rational integral. And to show you that they satisfy stronger property, stronger result than all the differential equations altogether, is that they satisfy the following stronger version of Johannoulou's theorem, is that if they do not admit a rational integral, then they have finitely many maximal invariant algebraic subvarieties. And this kind of result is used all the time in the model theoretic interpretation of differential Galois theory. And there's a third class of equation. This is the equation, the class I'm going to talk about mainly. This is called disintegrated differential equation or differential equation with trivial forking geometry. There are two different terminologies. And the intuition is that they are constituted of algebraic differential equations whose solutions are highly transcendental functions. And so to express what I mean by that, let me give you the example of Painlevé equations. So since I'm not a specialist of Painlevé equation, I'm just taking Painlevé 1, but many things that I said can be expressed in a more general setting. And from the model theory side, it has been started with the work of Pillay and Naglu. And so the first thing is that the solution of Painlevé equations define new transcendental functions. So this is what Painlevé was saying himself. And so what does that mean? It means that you cannot get a solution from of your differential equation by successive resolutions of differential equation which admit a differential Galois theory in the sense of Kolchin, so linear differential equation, elliptic equation, and the higher dimensional version, and algebraic equation of order one. So that Painlevé equation defines new transcendental function of order two. So I will give a precise statement formalizing this thing later. And the second property that they have is that the solutions share few algebraic relations. Indeed, here they share none of them. Is that every time you start with distinct solution of your differential equation, if you look at them with their first derivative, okay, because this is a second order equation, they will be algebraically independent. And so what does that mean that Zilber trichotomy holds in differentially closed field? It means that every algebraic differential equation can be broken down into finitely many indecomposable pieces. And each of these indecomposable pieces belong in one of these three categories. Okay, so this is a structural description of the universe of differential equations. And so one question that I've started working on since I started my PhD is that, is it possible to describe such a decomposition effectively for certain differential equations that appear in real life? And an idea that I started in my PhD is to study the case of a geodesic differential equation on a compact Riemannian surface with negative curvature. And why is it an interesting problem? The first thing is that it's a good approximation of what is a differential equation that appears in real life, because it's a non-completely integrable Hamiltonian system with 2 degrees of freedom, like many other interesting systems in classical mechanics. So this is a good approximation of what is a system that appears in real life. And the second thing is that we have a very good understanding of the dynamic of the vector field, okay, on the real locus necessarily. And it satisfies global hyperbolic properties, and this makes it easier to study than, for example, non-integrable Hamiltonian systems, which are closer to completely integrable ones. And the third reason that I didn't write here is that, of course, this is a differential equation that has many historical roots. And for this reason, it's interesting to study it also. So what do you need to do to study this thing? The first thing is that to apply Zilber's trichotomy, you need to work with algebraically presented Riemannian manifold, because you need to work with algebraic differential equations. So we will start with a compact Riemannian manifold, which is algebraically presented. And the second thing is that for the theorem that I just gave you to hold, you need to complexify the equation. It's a theorem about complex differential equation, not about differential equation defined over the field of real numbers. So you need to complexify your equation. And for that, the easiest thing to do is to complexify the Riemannian manifold you start with, and to start with a smooth algebraic variety, so defined over R, but you think about it as its complex point. You've got on it a non-degenerate symmetric two forms, which is also defined over R. And you look at the real points of these things, and the real point is a real analytic Riemannian manifold of dimension two with negative curvature. And so to make everything a bit compatible, what you need to assume is that the real point of your x are the real points of your variety are the risk indents in your variety. So let me describe a bit what we do about this with these equations. So you start. So I first give a picture of the real locus of the real points of the differential equation. So the real points of your is a compact Riemannian manifold of dimension two. So to define the geodesic differential equation, you can use the Levi-Civita connection. But here, to keep an algebraic framework, the simplest is to look at it as an Hamiltonian system. Okay, so you've got the free Hamiltonian, which is given by the kinetic energy. And when everything is given algebraically, the Hamiltonian himself defines the rational integral. And it tells you how to start your decomposition. So the first part of your decomposition will be the rational integral, and it's always the case when you want to start understanding this decomposition, the first thing you need to do is to understand the rational integrals. So here, the first part of your decomposition is the A1 on the right. And so what remains to understand is are the fibers. And all the fibers have the same analysis with respect to Zilber's trichotomy. So there's only one of them to study. So you see that there's two types of fibers. There are the fibers with positive energy, and they all have Zariskidens real points. And there's the fibers with negative energies that don't have real points. But if you look at them as complex, if you base change with C, they exactly look the same. And so the aim is to study this differential equation, which is the unitary geodesic differential equation of a Riemannian manifold. So this is a differential equation on the sphere bundle of this manifold. And the vector field is given by restricting the vector field on the tangent space of M to this sphere bundle. So this is a differential equation of order 3. And we want to study this decomposition in terms of Zilber trichotomy. So let me describe what we know about the dynamics of the real locus of this differential equation. So for that, we assume that our Riemannian manifold is compact, I did it before, and has negative curvature. Then it is known, so there are results of Anosov in 69, I think. And so why is it important to use this result from 69 and not older results? Is that to work with an algebraic structure, you cannot assume that the curvature is constant, because we don't know if there's any algebraically presented Riemannian manifold with constant negative curvature, but there are many with non-constant negative curvature. So you need to have results that allow the curvature to vary. And so even if you allow the curvature to vary, you've got a global hyperbolic structure. That is that you've got a decomposition of the tangent space of your sphere bundle. Remember that the sphere bundle has dimension 3, so this tangent space has dimension 3, and you have a decomposition into continuous line bundles, all these three line bundles are invariant under the differential of the flow of the vector field. Since we assume that M is compact, the flow of the vector field is complete. And the differential of the flow is exponentially contracting on one of them and exponentially expanding on the other one. And E itself is the direction of the vector field. So in particular, we assume that the vector field have no singularities in the real locus. Okay, this kind of properties implies that. So the second thing that is known is that they have many periodic points, is that the periodic points of your flow are dense in the sphere bundle. Okay, in the phase space of your differential equations, the periodic points are dense, and in fact, they have much stronger results, and you can prove that there are many periodic orbits in many different sense using what is called Anosov closing lemma, which shows that if you have a periodic an orbit which is close to be periodic, then you can find a periodic orbit which is not far away. And the third thing that we know is that we know many things about the ergodicity and mixing properties of the flow. And so the dynamic of the vector field it's really a real picture. It is topologically weakly mixing. And so there are many equivalent formulations of this weakly mixing property, especially for Anosov flow, because they are all equivalent. Topological mixing is equivalent to measure theoretic mixing for the right kind of measures. And weak mixing is equivalent to strong mixing. So I formulate the most natural condition to write down is that the flow itself, and if you look at the product of two copies of the flow, then it admits a dense orbit. Okay, and this implies, so you could ask, why do I stop at two copies of the flow and I don't look at higher copies of the flow, is that this implies, and this is not hard to see, that for all copies of the flow, it admits a dense orbit too. And we see that this kind of property will show up later, that what is important is to understand what happens in X and in X times X. And everything that happened in higher product is a consequence of what happened in X and X times X. The second thing is that we don't only have properties about, so the, in particular, the flow itself of the vector field, so the foliation defined by E, admit dense orbits, but we also have information about the ergodic properties of the two other foliations, and we know that the three foliations admit dense leaves. Okay, in fact, we even know that the foliation tangent to ES and EU, generally, all the leaves are dense. But these foliations are in general only C1, okay, and you cannot assume that they don't have a strong regularity. And so the aim, so what does the main theorem that I'm going to give you on the next slide is to take this dynamical picture on the real line, on the set of real points, and to produce from it a picture of the model theoretic structure. And so the picture looks like that. So you have to start with something that is already complexified. So you start with a pseudo-Riemannian variety over R, so that the real analytification is a compact Riemannian surface with negative curvature. Then you can say two things about the geodesic differential equation of XG. The first thing is that this is already indecomposable, not minimal, right? This differential equation of dimension 3 is already an indecomposable piece. So in model theory, we say minimal. And what does that mean is that the generic solution of your geodesic equation doesn't lie in a differential field of the form, so an extension of differential field of this form, where each step is either an algebraic extension, so you're just taking roots or solving a polynomial equation, a pure extension by constant, so in particular, this is what you do where you're taking rational integrals. So the second thing you can do, the second basic operation, is to solve a linear equation, an elliptic differential equation, or a higher dimensional version. So this is a strongly normal extension in the sense of Kolchin. And the third property that you can do is to take any extension, any differential extension generated by solutions of differential equation of order less than 3. So you see, this is what this is a version of the property that was expressed by Painlevé, saying that these functions define new transcendental functions. But the difference with Painlevé equation is that here we are in dimension 3, so there are new transcendental functions of dimension 3 that do not appear, that you cannot obtain by solving linear differential equation and differential equation of order 1 and differential equation of order 2. And the second property, which mimics the second property of Painlevé equation, that they had not at all any algebraic relations, is that here you can say that the solutions share few algebraic relations. That is that you've got two subsets, so one included in one copy, one included in the product of two copies. These two subsets are countable union of proper closed invariant algebraic subvarieties. So in particular, they are invariant by the flow. And if you want to know if solutions of your differential equation form a C algebraically independent set, you just have to check that none of the initial conditions belong to Z1. And if you take two different solutions and you look at the couple between two different initial conditions, then this couple doesn't belong to Z2. And you see the important part here is that there's no Z3, there's no Z4, there's no Z5. Right? It's like for the weakly mixing property, you only have to understand what happens in one copy of the differential equation and the product of two copies. So let me give a couple of comments. So the first thing is that I called it a qualitative description and not a quantitative description, is that to describe entirely the structure, if you want to describe exactly which structure it is, you exactly need to describe what is the Z1 and what are the Z2. What is Z1 and what is Z2? So what are they? You can always pick them, so they are maximal. They are maximal choice for Z1 and Z2 if you want, and you can always pick Z1 and Z2 to be the union of all proper closed invariant subvariety of S of the copy of S, Z1 for one copy of the differential equation and Z2 for two copies of the differential equation. So you see that in particular, you can interpret the element of Z2 as generically, okay, the element of Z2 that projects generically on both factors as generically finite to finite correspondence of your differential equation. And so in that case, in this case that we're studying here, it's not hard to see that they have at most countably many maximal elements. So you can always assume that these things are countable. But an interesting question is to try to understand if they are always finite. And this is natural to believe that they are always finite. There's even, I mean, I don't know any example where I can see that they are not even trivial, so that Z1 is not equal to the empty set, and Z2 is not equal to the diagonal. But one problem that one runs into is that the fin structure of Z1 and Z2 can depend on the chosen compact Riemannian manifold. And so you might have to study specific cases to show that in some cases they are trivial. And the other thing is that you have some elements in Z1. So here it's a complex picture that I'm giving you. So in particular, nothing tells you that element Z1 and Z2 have very skid. I mean, you can see everything about the real points. So maybe you've got some variety that have only complex points, and it's very hard to know how you're going to be able to study this kind of varieties just knowing information about the real dynamic. The second thing I want to express is, okay, I told about generic solutions, and what does that mean here is that an analytic solution, so if you look at it as an analytic curve defined on a complex disk and with value in S the sphere bundle, then it's generic if its image is not contained in Z1. So if you know how to describe Z1, you also make the first statement quantitative, because you don't need to talk about most solution. You really can express exactly which solution you are talking about. But in any case, from this perspective, you can see that Z1 is very small, so that the first part of this theorem applies to most geodesics. Okay, in particular, you can find periodic geodesics, for example, for which it applies to. And so what is the key idea of the proof, and the key idea of the model theoretic proof, is that to prove this theorem, what we do is that we study algebraic correspondences between the differential equation and indecomposable differential equation in each of Zilber's trichotomy. Okay, instead of trying to describe the structure directly, we try to describe morphism onto structures that we know how to describe. Instead of trying to describe the structure, so it's very natural approach. And each of this class, when you study the algebraic correspondence with each of this class, you have a different flavor, which is based on why the definition of this class that I didn't give you. So let me talk about the first thing to do, the first thing that I did. And so let me first define what I mean exactly by algebraic correspondence between two differential equations. So all the differential equations that will appear will be autonomous, defined as an algebraic variety and a vector field. And you see, so if you have two differential equations like that, you can undo the product with a product vector field. And you say that what is a non-trivial algebraic correspondence between these two differential equations? This is a proper closed invariant sub-variety of x times y. And by invariant, I mean invariant by the product vector field, projecting generically on both factors. And what does that mean, that the differential equation is orthogonal to the constant? Okay, it means that there's no algebraic correspondence with the differential equation of the second class, which admits a differential Galois theory in the sense of Kolchin. And of course, you need to take into account this plus or minus epsilon, is that Kolchin doesn't take into account has to suppress the rational integral. So you have also to assume that your equation doesn't admit a rational integral. And so the first question is how to prove that a differential equation has no algebraic correspondence with all the differential equation of which admit the differential equation of the in the sense of Kolchin. And for that, I prove a theorem in my thesis, right, which is very, very, I think that can be very useful to do these things, and in particular applies to the geodesics equation in negative curvature, is that if you start with a differential equation, so which is autonomous and defined over the field of real numbers, if you assume that you've got a compact inside your real point, which is Zariski dense in X, so that C is the generic point of X, and okay, constituted of regular point of X of R, if you assume that X is smooth, it. You don't need to assume that here you have regular points. And your compact is invariant under the vector field, under the local real analytic flow of the vector field. Then the flow of the vector field on this compact is complete. So you denoted K phi t. And if this flow is topologically weakly mixing, then your equation is orthogonal to the constant. And so this is an obstruction. This is in itself an obstruction for complete solvability by linear differential equation, elliptic differential equation, and the higher dimensional version. Okay, this is a weakening of the conclusion that I wrote here. So if your flow, if your real analytic flow is weakly mixing, you cannot solve your equation by using only linear differential equation, elliptic differential equation, and higher dimensional version of this thing, which admit the differential Galois theory in the sense of Kolchin. So I did that in my thesis, and so how to go further than that? And the hard part was to identify the right geometric condition to be able to go further than that and to prove the theorem that I wrote before. And the kind of condition that we came up with, mainly with my PhD advisor, is the following thing, that we can prove the following theorem, is that if you have a prime number and you assume that the differential equation, you start with a differential equation of dimension p, if you know how to do the condition that I just wrote down, so that xv is orthogonal to the constant, and you know two supplementary information, you know that every foliation on x which is invariant under the vector field has a Zariski dense leaf. And the second thing that you know is that every p web of foliation by curves on x which is invariant under the vector field v has a red Zariski dense leaf. So if you have these two types of geometric information plus the information that you're orthogonal to the constant, you don't have algebraic relations with differential equation of the which admit a differential Galois theory in the sense of Kolchin, then the conclusion of the main theorem holds. And so basically you apply that for the prime number p. So let's just give me what exactly I mean by a foliation here. I just mean a saturated coherent subshift of the locally free shift. So here I assume that x is smooth, stable under the Lie bracket. And it's called invariant under the vector field V if V is an infinitesimal symmetry of your foliation. And R web of foliation by curve on X is just a closed subvariety of the projective tangent space, such that all irreducible components dominate X and the projection is generically finite. And once again, you've got a natural action on the vector field on that, which allows to define the notion of invariant. Okay? And so the final picture that I want to give you is that how to understand this Zilbert trichotomy for geodesic equation on the surface. So what I just said is that on a compact surface with negative curvature, this geodesic equation is indecomposable and disintegrated. And so you can compare that with other results that exist in the literature. The first one is that on an ellipsoid, these are results of Jacobi that say that the geodesic equation is always decomposable. The Hamiltonian system is completely integrable. And all of its indecomposable pieces admit a Galois theory in the sense of Kolchin. And you have some mixed cases. If you want to see some mixed cases, you can look at a surface of revolution. And for surfaces of revolution, you always have a completely integrable Hamiltonian system. So the geodesic equation will always be decomposable. But in some cases, you can observe some mixed situation where some of the indecomposable pieces admit a Galois theory in the sense of Kolchin, and others do not. Okay, and I'll stop here.
Thank you very much, Hemi. Are there questions or comments?
Could you just go a couple of slides back where there was a theorem about decomposition? Yes. No. Well, just to the... Yes. This one.
Yes. Thank
you. So there is a question by Thiago about this slide. Why P? Why is it important P to be a prime?
So there's probably... I mean, there are versions of that where P is not prime, but the important is that... So what should be the answer if P is not prime, if you start with an N? You should look at K wave W of foliations of rank L with K times L is equal to N. So the property that P is prime is used to reduce on the number. Here, I only have to study webs of foliation by curves. And I don't have to study webs of codimension one foliation or webs of codimension two foliation because of prime number P. If you relax this assumption and you assume that there's no invariant web at all in any possible way, then you don't need P to be prime probably.
Okay.
But my main motivation was to do for P equals 3. And I realized that the argument doesn't use 3, it just uses that 3 is prime.
And one question is not related to this result, but more to the problematic. Does this does our knowledge of John Lu foliation in degree 2 now allows us to say that it's disintegrated or something like that?
So the first thing is that you always have to pick the vector field, not only the foliation. So, but here there was explanation of how to pick a natural vector field associated to that. And so in that case, it's probably true, but because it's structured, so the generic vector field is disintegrated, and since it's structurally stable, if it was not disintegrated, then the generic vector field will not be disintegrated. So I think for this reason, it should be known that the Johann-Lu vector field is disintegrated.
Okay. Tiago, why aren't you speaking? You can turn on your camera and ask directly.
So in theory, there should be a Zilbert trichotomy for algebraic PDEs, but we know nothing about it. The critical point here is that we can show that you're not in the third class. To show that you are in this class, in the disintegrated case, you prove that you're not in the two first cases, basically. And so it requires a good understanding of the two first cases to do that. If you don't have any understanding of these two first cases, then you're not using anything. Here, what I'm using is that we exactly know how to classify these two cases to show that something is in the third case if it's not in the two first cases and it's not decomposable. And you see that this example here admits an invariant foliation, which is algebraically integrable. This first example that I gave here. This is why if you don't have a foliation, there's a foliation by curve which is invariant.
Thank you. Yeah, what I thought is that I can think of examples. The examples you gave, I can think of higher dimensional examples of each one of them. So I was wondering if there's a version in several variables of the same thing.
No, but it's hard. We know few things in model theory about what happens with two derivation or a derivation plus an automorphism. We want to understand these cases, but the cases we understand well is one derivation and one automorphism. But if you start mixing them, the model theory becomes more complicated. It doesn't mean that it's inaccessible, but I think it's hard.
Okay, thank you.
Any other question or comment? Okay. Well, thanks again, Hamid. It was very interesting.